individual students have been working really hard for the last two semesters conducting systematic literature reviews on an issue that they feel passionately about, so something related to public health. And they dug into the literature in a systematic fashion to figure out what evidence was there connecting the exposure that they were interested in and to the outcome that they were interested in. And they worked, they can tell you, they worked really hard last semester to do that systematic lit review. And then this semester, they've been practicing communicating that, their findings to broad audiences, from policymakers to the general public, to try to affect change related to those issues. And this is the second time that we've done the CE as a course, rather than just everybody sort of scrounging for projects and desperately trying to finish on time. And hopefully it's improved since the last time around. I think these guys have had to struggle with me as I've developed this course, but it's been very rewarding working with all of you guys. I think you'll see from these talks that this is the next generation of public health professionals that are really going to affect positive change in the world, and it makes me really proud and proud to see them go out and present this research and then go out and make change. So thank you for letting me be part of it, and I'm excited to see you present. So I'll pass it on to George.
Hi, I am here to introduce our first speaker, Tawny Freeman. Tawny is in our PA and PH program. So she is, one thing I found, she's used to working hard, and she worked very hard on this. The fact that she wanted to go first tells you a little bit about her. I mean, she's just one of those people, wants to like take on a problem and get it done, and also then be able to relax, which is nice. So Tawny came to us from Oklahoma State University, where she got a degree in nutrition sciences. And one of the things you'll see is that her interest in nutrition is part of what informed her topic, where she's going to talk to us about the relationship between CO2, rice, and zinc. Tawny.
Thank you so much, Dr. Price and Dr. Gray. Thank you everyone for being here today. My name is Tawny Freeman, and I'm presenting my CE, CO2, rice, and zinc. I'm going to briefly go through these three topics for my CE, and then I'll do a breakdown of the literature review itself. Before I begin, I'd just like to tell you a little bit more about myself. So as Dr. Gray mentioned, I'm in the PA and PH program in the Global Environmental Health track here at GW. Before coming to GW, I have a background in nutrition. I was working in mental health and eating disorders for a few years before I came here. So, you know, just all things food related are kind of interest to me. Also, since joining GW, I really developed a strong interest in climate change and climate change related research. So this topic really just made sense for me. Also, recently I started my practicum in January at the USDA's National Institute of Food and Agriculture, where I'm actually doing another literature review. So lucky me, I did this one. So, you know, it's really come in handy much more quickly than I had anticipated. So climate change, the first topic. I know I have a cheesy quote from an early 2000s rap song on here, but you know, obviously, climate change is no joke. I don't need to go into the details of climate change with all of you. I think we know it pretty well, but I will highlight a few things that we know for sure. So we know that carbon dioxide is increasing in the atmosphere, and it's increasing at a very fast rate. We also know that the climate change effects are impacting our planet in a variety of ways. So things like changes in weather patterns, like drought, flooding, extreme heat, elevated carbon dioxide, increasing ozone, these are all having impacts on our planet, and not just human health, but animal health and environmental health as well. And so one of those more recent findings or discoveries has been about food quality. So rice. These pictures on the slide are meant to illustrate just how important rice is in so many different cultures and populations across the globe. Rice is a staple food source for more than one half of the world's population, and FAO estimates that 2.3 billion people are using rice for at least 60% of their dietary zinc intake. These vulnerable populations are often in developing countries, and they're not able to get adequate zinc intake through more traditional food sources like meat products, dairy products, fortified foods such as cereals, as we do in more developed countries, because of either access or cost. And so these vulnerable populations are reliant on these specific grains like rice to get not only their overall caloric needs, but also micronutrient needs as well, like zinc. And And then zinc. So what is zinc? Well, first of all, it's a micronutrient, and micronutrients are vitamins or minerals that humans need every day in small amounts for proper functioning. So if we're not getting these adequate amounts, it leads to zinc deficiency often. And so zinc deficiency, it's characterized as a cycle, and it usually begins with compromised immunity. And compromised immunity, I should also mention that it largely impacts children under 5 in these developing countries for the reasons that I mentioned previously. And so for this population, the compromised immunity, it needs things like increased susceptibility to things like lower respiratory infections, malaria, diarrhea. And we already know that diarrhea is the second leading cause of death for this population globally. So if you're having chronic diarrhea or these other issues, it can also lead to malnutrition. And malnutrition, it's because you're not absorbing these nutrients that you need. And so if this is sustained over time, it can lead to things like cognitive dysfunction and impairment. And then these three things combined, if they're sustained over long periods of time, it will lead to stunting. And stunting is severely impaired growth and development. And then stunting puts a child at increased risk of chronic diseases later in life, which would then perpetuate the cycle again of compromised immunity. So what does this all mean for human health, this combination of factors? And what does the evidence say so far? Well, the body of evidence really began in the 1990s, whenever researchers were beginning to notice that climate change was impacting food and food production more specifically. So there were a few studies done, but they were mostly focused on wheat and protein and iron, not really on rice or zinc or other micronutrients. In the subsequent years, there were a few more studies done, not many, but they were finding conflicting results. And so a few more studies were done. They were looking at a wider array of climate conditions and also micronutrients, but still there wasn't any conclusive evidence about this specific association. And so that's why I developed this PICO statement. It was that body of evidence that really helped me formulate this PICO statement. And so I asked, do elevated levels of carbon dioxide decrease zinc concentrations in rice? And so my population was rice grown under elevated carbon dioxide conditions. The effect was carbon dioxide itself. The comparator was rice grown under ambient levels of carbon dioxide. And the outcome was potential changes in zinc concentrations in rice. So this is just a brief overview of the methodology that we all went through. We're all very familiar with the navigation guide. So at each step, we were able to use specific protocols that helped us get us to the overall conclusions at the end about the body of evidence that we were researching. So for me, my search strategy, it started with going through all the literature, finding relevant search terms, some of them being mesh terms. I also consulted librarians at Ross Hills Library. They helped me develop more search terms and really just getting guidance on how to go about the search process and then also how to compile the data once I had it. So I use databases like Scopus, PubMed, Web of Science, Google Scholar, and I use search terms such as these, so rice, elevated or increased carbon dioxide, and zinc. And then that search strategy yielded 992 articles, 987 of which were from a database, 5 were from the gray literature. 178 of those were duplicates, so it left me with 814 unique articles. Of those articles, we went through our first screening, which was by title and abstract. And the exclusion criteria at this point were if the article had any original data, if zinc was measured, and if carbon dioxide, if rice was a population. And that screening left us with only 6 for this full text analysis. So at that point, the exclusion criteria were if elevated carbon dioxide was the main exposure to rice, or if I discovered that it met any of the previous exclusion criteria. And that left me with 3 articles for the final analysis. So this slide really just talks about the key study characteristics from those 3 studies. And first, I'd like to highlight that each study or each article used a different study design, but they did use the same exposure for each study, which was 200 ppm CO2 above ambient. So for the first study, it was done in 2004, and they used a FACE study design, which is free air concentration CO2 enrichment. And so basically, this is meant to simulate a natural environment. It's done outside, and it's usually 25 to 30 meters in diameter, and they're using pipes to filter in the CO2 at certain points of the day, so they can kind of control the CO2 in that way. They used a Japanese rice cultivar, and over 2 years, they found that at this percentage change,
The laser doesn't work at this.
You can see that in this study, they found that zinc was actually increasing as carbon dioxide increased. The next study that was done about this specific region used to sunlight fumigation study design. So basically, this is an artificial environment. And so it's inside, and they can control every aspect of the environment. And so they used a Chinese rice cultivar, and they actually found that zinc was decreasing at this person exchange as carbon dioxide was increasing. In the last study, they used an open-top chamber study design. And this is essentially like the FACE study design. It's outdoors, it's a natural environment, except it's smaller. And they also found that zinc was decreasing as carbon dioxide increased, and they used two rice cultivars. And what I'd like you to notice from this slide is that the latter two studies, they have the same direction of effect, and also have similar magnitudes of effect. And so based on all of that, we were able to evaluate the risk of bias across studies, the strength of the body of evidence, and the strength of the evidence, or quality, I don't know if I switched that. But collectively, all of this is called the weight of the evidence. And so for the risk of bias, we used common domains like exposure and outcome assessment, other bias, conflict of interest, but we had to throw in a new one, rice selection, just because I wasn't actually looking at human populations, I was looking at rice. So that's the new one. And as you can see, most of the domains are judged as low or probably low risk, with the exception of the weighing at all for rice selection. And this is because they chose a rice cultivar that was actually heat sensitive. And so for their study, they were looking at two scenarios. So one of them was not only elevated carbon dioxide, but another scenario of elevated carbon dioxide in conjunction with heat stress. And so I felt like this was a bit questionable, and so that's why I gave it that rating. But overall, I felt like the risk of bias across studies was probably low risk. For the quality of the body of evidence, I judged it as moderate for three reasons. So there was that variability in the study design, and I felt like that could have potentially made it more difficult to compare results. Also for the rice cultivar selection of that one study, and then also there wasn't a clear direction of effect or magnitude. So I felt like those things collectively, I judged it as moderate. And then from there, I was able to assess the strength of the body of evidence, and I judged it as insufficient to assess this potential association. So all of that being said, you know, there's a lot to consider, and we've learned a lot about the state of this research. The first thing I want to touch on is the strengths and the limitations. So I think we all would have appreciated more time to complete these study design, or these literature reviews, rather. If I had had more time, I probably would have expanded my search terms, maybe made PICO statements so that my search wasn't so narrow. Maybe this would have yielded more results and strengthened my weight of evidence rating, and maybe even used more databases. The next thing, varied study design. So as I mentioned, you know, this was, in my opinion, a limitation, but it could have been a strength. You know, there's not a preferred study design method right now for this type of study or like these conditions. So I think maybe it's helpful that we were getting these results from different studies and we can kind of compare and potentially see if there is a preferred method for this. Also, you know, there's just not a lot of data out there. You know, the body of evidence isn't going to be strong because there's only three studies to really compare. But this is a recent area. I think it's gaining momentum, and I really do think that in the coming years there will be more research to strengthen this body of evidence. And also, you know, no language or date restrictions, and this is the first of its kind. So what do we need to know to close these knowledge gaps and to get more conclusive evidence? Well, obviously, I think we need more research. I think it would be helpful if we had one study design that was being done, you know, to test these conditions. I don't know if we need the same rice cultivar, but potentially. We also need to know if there's a consistent direction of effect. So we need to know if it's either decreasing, increasing, and if we do have that, we need to know what's the magnitude. Is there a dose response? Things like that. And if we have those answers, what does that mean for human health, and what are the implications? So I think first and foremost, it would exacerbate the zinc deficiency that's already being experienced in these populations that I mentioned. And also, it's proposed to reach 150 to 200 million new people. So that's a lot. Also, another thing to consider is that zinc deficiency is already likely underestimated globally. And this is because, as I mentioned, it's not associated with just one adverse health outcome. It's actually underlying many adverse health outcomes, so it's not easy to pinpoint how many people it's affecting. Also, there are issues with detection, so there's not an easy or inexpensive way to measure zinc deficiency in these populations. Also, there would be issues with supplementation. It's not a vitamin that can accumulate in the body over time, so that we don't have to have it every day. It's something that we need every day in these small amounts. So it would be hard and potentially costly to distribute it to these hard-to-reach populations that need it most. And also, this would lead to issues with mitigation. So they would have to be really creative and innovative kind of ways to mitigate or ameliorate these issues, whether it's through public health interventions with supplementation, whether it's through breeding a new rice cultivar that's maybe potentially resistant to these climate change effects. Whatever it may be, I think there would still be issues. Let's, you know, go further down that rabbit hole. If we were breeding a new rice cultivar, it could potentially raise the prices of rice, and these populations probably still wouldn't be able to access it or even be able to afford it. So, yeah, there are a lot of things to consider. In conclusion, you know, this topic of food quality and climate change, you know, there's some work that's been done, but I think there's a lot more to be done. And I'll just reiterate, you know, we're at a very critical time in environmental health research, and it's my hope that this specific association is focused on sooner rather than later.
Climate change, drought is also enormously important.
Yes.
Is there a connection between the two in terms of zinc?
You know, I'm not sure exactly if there's a connection. Obviously, there's a connection with climate change, like elevated carbon dioxide in drought. And I know a lot of studies were not only looking at just carbon dioxide, because I don't think that that's the only thing that's affecting food. You know, obviously, drought, extreme heat, flooding, they're all having an impact. And I think they're just trying to figure out which one is potentially having the largest impact, or which one they can kind of mitigate first. And I think it's kind of hard to maybe put those two together in one study. But I did see that happening in a lot of studies.